Good evening, everybody. Thank you very much for coming for the first of our two convention watches. Next week, 1 week from tonight, we'll be watching President Obama as he accepts the Democratic nomination for president. But tonight, of course, first we'll be listening to Governor Romney as he delivers his acceptance speech. For those of you I haven't met so far, my name is Dan Schnur, and I'm the director of the Jess Unruh Institute of Politics here at USC. And we're co-sponsoring tonight's program, along with the Annenberg School for Communication and along with the Center for Communications Leadership. We hope, in addition to staying with us for tonight's speech, afterwards we'll be having a panel discussion, as we always do after these types of programs. And we'll be joined by both student, faculty, and political experts. Not that students and faculty aren't political experts, but you get my point. In any case, in addition to watching Governor Romney, we'll hope you'll stick around for the conversation, because in addition to hearing what our experts have to say, we're going to want to hear from all of you with your questions and comments. So thanks very much for coming. Enjoy the program, enjoy the pizza, and we'll be back after Governor Romney's finished. Thanks very much. All right, just before we get started, is a quick reminder that there's still a little bit of pizza left, if anybody'd still like some. And second, for those of you who are in either the the Journalism 458 class or the MDA 475 course and are looking for extra credit from tonight's event, we'll be sending around a sign-in sheet. As I mentioned at the outset, at the conclusion of the speech, we're going to have a panel discussion with a range of experts. And although I certainly want to ask all three of our experts, and I'll introduce them in just a moment, what I think are the most important things about the speech and to get their thoughts on them. In short order, we want to open this up to all of you as well. So if you have questions that you'd like to ask any of the four of us after having watched the speech, take a minute and listen to what these guys have to say, and then we'll open it up to a broader discussion and conversation. Let me take a minute and introduce our panel, and then we'll get started. Sitting directly to my right is Gabriel Kahn. And Gabe is a professor here at Annenberg, but he's a former Los Angeles bureau chief for the Wall Street Journal. He has been watching local, state, and national politics for many years. And we're very, very eager to hear what Gabe has to say tonight. Gabe, thanks very much for joining us.
Thank you.
Sitting next to Gabe is our student panelist, and for those of you who haven't come to our programs in past years, you should know that for all the programming we do with the Unruh Institute, whether it's evening programs like this one or our lunch discussions every Wednesday in the Taper Center, we have a rule. We believe that every one of our programs ought to include students not just as audience members, but as participants and panelists as well. And for this discussion tonight, we're very lucky to have Alex Yebri. Alex is the president of USC Trojans for Mitt Romney, and he has just returned from a summer internship in Boston where he interned for the Romney campaign. Alex, welcome back. Thanks for coming. And finally, for those of you who have attended our programs in the past, you will welcome you'll recognize our third and final panelist. Margita Thompson is a good friend of mine and a wonderful friend of the Unruh Institute and our students. She was the press secretary for Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger. She was the communications director for the Bush for President campaign here in California in the year 2000, and is currently the vice president for corporate communications and Latino programs at Health Net. Margita, thanks very much for coming back. So Gabe, I'm going to start with you, and I'm going to ask you the same question that I'm going to put to all three of our guests. Simply put, what was Mitt Romney's biggest challenge going into tonight's speech, and did he accomplish it? Did he meet that challenge?
Well, I think that one of the biggest challenges, and part of the whole sort of theme of this convention, has been to try to sort of humanize Mitt and sort of bridge this gap that he clearly has with Obama in his ability to connect to, let's just call it, the average American, the typical American. And I think that's kind of a lot of what had been underlying the last couple of days. That was certainly what was behind the Ann Romney speech, which I think, you know, had a certain degree of success in that quarter. And looking at this tonight, I mean, I think that there are a few moments, particularly when he talks about his early days, his marriage, his family, where I think it actually does sort of hit the right notes on that, and sort of bring this man who is, you know, notoriously stiff, never a hair out of place, does make him seem a little bit more real and a little bit less of a sort of action figure kind of personality. But, you know, Mitt is Mitt, and I think that if we really knew the man, if we were going to really get to know the man, we would have had opportunities to do that over the last 6 months. And I still think that, you know, they've gotten part of the way there, but I don't think they've crossed the end zone there.
Alex, same question to you. You worked for the campaign over the course of the summer. You watched his press and communications staff work to develop answers to the type of challenges that Gabe has just been talking about. What did you see as his most important objective in tonight's speech, and do you think he hit it?
Well, over the last couple of months, you've seen the Barack Obama campaign spend a lot of money to try to frame Mitt Romney early. This is something that you've seen in prior elections, but this year it's been straight out there in front of the people. He's gone to swing states, and he's tried to frame Mitt Romney as somebody that people can't relate to. Most independent voters at this point in the campaign really don't know much about Mitt Romney. This was his first time on the stage to really show the American people who he was, what he stands for, what his career path, what goals he has, and what vision he has for this country. So I think, I agree with that. I think the personality aspect of it, American voters, they really want to connect with their president. They want to like their president. They want to know, like a celebrity, their public life, their private life, everything about them. And Mitt Romney, to tell you the truth, I had the opportunity to work on his campaign. And what you see is really what you get. This guy, he's here, he's had a great career path. He has shown his skills that he's ready to take on. And he, in my opinion, really hit the notes going forward. He gave a speech that was more about his personal life. Something that on the stump he doesn't do as much because he's focused on the path at hand and the focus of actually getting this economy in the right direction. And tonight, I think you really hit it out of the ballpark on that respect.
Now, Margita, you worked for candidates at the state and national level. And on one hand, you know how important a speech like this can be. On the other hand, it's part of a broader messaging and communications framework. 1 hour, even on primetime national television, is not going to decide a campaign's outcome one way or the other, but it could have a significant impact. What about tonight's?
Absolutely. I think it's a two-pronged approach in that for his speech, he needed to show that he had a plan, and he needed to show his personality, who he was as a person. I think a lot of times analysts are saying we already know Mitt Romney, and the bottom line is most people don't, and this is about the time when people start paying attention. But you also have to take it a step further. This isn't just about the speech. This is about the staging. You saw how he walked in through the people, allowing him to make that connection. Normally you see candidates coming automatically through the back of the stage going forward. It also was about who was speaking before him. You had Rubio, who was a fabulous person to introduce him, showing a generational shift, more diversity. You had Clint Eastwood that was a little bit more raw and authentic, that thing that people really want, that red meat, but doing it in a way that was very charismatic and funny. And then you have the accumulation of 3 days, where you've really had people who have given fabulous speeches that are putting a package together of what this broad vision is of what a Romney presidency would look like.
Just a reminder for everybody, as I mentioned earlier, 1 week from tonight we'll be gathering here again to watch President Obama's acceptance speech and have a discussion about that address after he finishes. But in the meantime, I just want to pick up on one thing that I think all of you have heard from each of the three panelists. They all talked in a different way about the importance for Romney tonight of emotionally connecting with the audience. And just to give you a little bit of perspective, I think, on why everyone up here thinks that that was believes that that was such an important task, is the Washington Post came out with a poll earlier this week that showed the following. It showed that for the most part, voters in America still liked and still respected Barack Obama to a very great degree, but there were increasing doubts about his abilities to fix the nation's economy. Romney, on the other hand, was judged by a majority of voters to be more capable of understanding the nation's economic challenges than Obama. But voters didn't trust him to look out for their interests, and in fact said in fairly large numbers that they thought he'd look out after the interests of wealthy voters rather than middle-class voters. So what you heard from Margita and Alex and Gabe here, all in a slightly different way, is Mitt Romney's job tonight, or at least one of them, was to say, hey, look, you can trust me. And the first step toward developing trust is toward developing that that emotional connection. So, Margita, I'm going to come back to you. Liking somebody, you know, the cliche that some of you may have heard over the years is, do we want to have a beer with this guy? Now, let's agree that's a sort of an unfair question to ask of a Mormon. But putting that aside, is that what people are looking for, as opposed to someone with a better plan for the economy, someone with a more specific idea of fixing the nation's public schools, someone with a better idea of how to deal with our international challenges, or someone who they'd rather have a beer with? Why is that likability, why is that emotional connection such an important thing?
You know, it's an interesting question to ask of a communicator. Because right now, PR, communications here at the Annenberg School, it's all about creating a sense of authenticity. Everyone wants to be authentic. You want your CEOs to be authentic. You want your public officials to be authentic. And Mitt Romney is a CEO, and that authenticity is a little bit of that, the appearance of detachment, the analytical. He is not your Oprah Winfrey, empathy-spewing type of person that might fit into a Kardashian episode. Not ever going to happen. So he's authentic to himself. Is that something that people in this time are willing to be able to overlook, but what matters more? I think that as you see people more and more realizing that this decision is going to impact their daily life, maybe you'll see people willing to overcome that, who do I like more or not, and really looking at the issues.
Okay. You know, Gabe, what struck me in listening to tonight's speech, listening to Romney in particular talking about his family and talking about his religion and talking about his business background, is he really did fill in a lot of blanks about his life experience in a way that we hadn't heard over the last several months on the campaign. In retrospect, might it have been to his benefit to have been talking about this all along?
Oh, or is it more of a... No, I think you're right. I mean, he really tried to reframe the Bain narrative. It's a little too little, a little too late here. I think he's kind of seeded that one early on. And I think that's a major issue even in this likability thing. I mean, let's face it, this is a popularity contest. If it were a policy contest, we would have heard a lot more about policy. But it's really about popularity, it seems, and the way that they presented it. But I think that, the Bain narrative, as he put it forth tonight, you know, felt a lot more warm and cuddly than I've heard it described previously. Still, I think that's a huge challenge. I think the issues of his tax returns are going to be still play a major part in this. And I think that that's really, you know, you heard a lot about people who might earn $9 an hour. I found that a little bit difficult to kind of believe coming from the voice of Mitt, whom I don't really necessarily associate with someone who mixes well with the working class. I think that as they really try to hit those notes, that's where their voice cracks the most.
So the challenge, one of the challenges, Alex, as this develops, is here you've got an individual who has developed a tremendous amount of wealth over the course of his professional career. That's there, and that is a potential obstacle. On the flip side, at least what the polling shows, is a lot of voters translate that into someone who does understand economic issues. What struck me about tonight's speech, there were certainly very brief references to education, to foreign policy, and so on. What struck me more than anything else is when Romney was not establishing the kind of emotional connection that we were talking about, that we have been talking about, he was talking about the economy and nothing else. I take it, and you had some insight from this summer, that Romney and his advisors believe that while all the other issues matter to voters, none of them matter nearly as much, and this election's going to go one way or the other based on that one single issue. Is that fair?
Interestingly, I would go back to the 1992 campaign, and I would look at Bill Clinton's speech in the convention. Before his convention speech, Bill Clinton was kind of known as the same elitist person who, you know, went to Harvard, went to Oxford. He wasn't somebody that people could connect with, Yale and Oxford. And he came up there and he gave a speech. He connected with voters. He talked about his family. He talked about how he lost his father months before he was born. And he talked about how his mother raised him and how he really did a great job of connecting with the base and the independent voters, as well as talking about the economy, which is the main focus. People right now, when you ask them, what do you care about? In all polls, I think 70 to 80%, they care about the economy. That's the number one focus. So I think it's a balance. It's a balancing act between those two. The person who's running for president needs to be liked. He needs to be respected as well. And tonight, I think you saw a side of Mitt Romney that he hasn't been showing as much because the campaign really wanted to hit on the notes of the economy. And going forward, I think this is going to build a lot of momentum and help him in the polls.
Gabe, I want to come back to you because you said something earlier that I partially agree with. You said this campaign isn't about policy, it's a popularity contest. And I might, and reasonable people can disagree on this, and it's the kind of thing we can have a good conversation about more broadly in just a minute or two. I'm not sure I'd go quite that far. And I'd suggest, we've been talking a lot about likability, and I guess my thinking on this over the years has developed in the following way. That it's not so much a matter of liking a political leader, but rather trusting them. And I think that most voters, whether they care to admit it or not, really don't know exactly what the right kind of economic stimulus package is. They don't precisely know which brand of healthcare is the best way to make the system work. And they say, okay, which one of these two individuals do I trust more to make the right decision? So to me, it's less of a popularity contest than a weighing for voters of which candidate establishes a level of trust that can make the policy decisions that voters care about. Is that fair?
I'd phrase it a little bit differently. Yeah. And again, I mean, I think that throughout this entire convention, I have heard very little about policy, and I expect to hear very little next week as well.
But are you speaking specifically about the convention?
I'm speaking right now about the conventions. The campaign is slightly different. The campaign is a bigger beast, and it's got, you can certainly find more elements in there. But there's two ways to look at the economy. I think it's clear that the economy is the issue. It was the issue 4 years ago as well. But it's really, there's no escaping it now. But there's two ways to approach that. One, there's the who's the guy who knows more about business, might know more about economics. And I think that's pretty clear in the minds of voters that Romney has a bit of an edge there. But then the other aspect of the economy is who can feel your pain, right? And you mentioned Bill Clinton a moment ago. Well, Bill Clinton certainly knew how to feel people's pain. Bill Clinton could certainly walk onto the set of the Kardashians and probably, not miss a beat, right?
You might want to rephrase that.
That's true. I'm sorry. Oops. Let's not get the Clinton near the Kardashians. Very clearly, I think that Obama is the person who can kind of, feel the pain of those who have been affected by economic dislocation in a way that Mitt Romney can. And I think that he's clearly uncomfortable in that setting, too. And I think that that's actually where the economic focus of this campaign tilts towards Obama.
I think what happens with Mitt Romney is that he's a decent man and he's a humble man. And those are two very difficult traits to have when you're running for president, because you need to be very willing to tout yourself, and you have to be willing to go bare knuckle, especially with a Chicago politician who's used to that bare knuckle thing, and that's just not a place of comfort for him.
And I think once again we get back to the poll numbers that I was talking about a moment ago. On one hand, voters say, well, we think Romney may understand these issues better. We're not quite sure if he cares as much about us as we need him to. Margita, I want to come back to you in just a sec. We're talking about establishing an emotional connection with voters. And for any candidate, that connection is easier to make with some voters than others. For Romney in particular, there's two voter groups that I know you've spent a lot of time thinking about, not just in this campaign, but over the years, that have been greater challenges for Romney and for the Republican candidates. And in particular, those voter groups are female voters and Latino voters. Talk a little bit about Romney's speech tonight and whether it has the ability to increase his support in either or both of those constituencies.
Sí. I think that it's not just Romney's speech, but also the whole campaign really has been geared towards highlighting the impact of women and Latinos. It was really fun for me. I really saw my face a lot of times in the people who were speaking, from Susana Martinez, the governor of New Mexico, to even today, earlier, before the coverage started, you had Craig Romney, I think it was the son Craig, who was out there, and he gave some remarks in Spanish, impeccable Spanish, absolutely fantastic. So I think with the Latino community, it is a lot about emotion and making that connection, and I think that you can make some inroads. It's very hard because a lot of times people use this marker of immigration as that's what should be the number one issue that's of importance to the Latino community. But I have to say, right behind education is the economy and job creation. And so you see this pivot that Mitt Romney's trying to make, where he may not be comfortable talking about how he's the personification of the Horatio Alger American dream, which is something that I think all Americans should aspire to as opposed to fear and resent. But at the same time, he's the one that's creating those jobs for those folks. So the people that were coming in between, that were the folks that had been employed by companies created by Mitt Romney, that's something that people can really relate to. You have someone like Rubio introducing Mitt Romney, that's absolutely fantastic, showing the importance of the Latino community and a prominence of the Latino community in a way that's related to hope and not fear and resentment. Awesome.
If only they didn't show the crowd at the convention, it would really seem that there's a...
Well, but if you look at me, would you be able to tell if I'm Latino or not?
No, but I can certainly tell that a lot of the folks in that audience... let's face it, guys. And Romney has been criticized about this, and even some of the campaign commercials he's cut. It's pretty lily white.
We saw Condoleezza Rice. We saw Susana Martinez. We saw so many female voices out there. We saw a lot of Hispanic voices out there.
We have to acknowledge that there's a tremendous gap with both of those constituencies.
And let me offer this, and then we can come back to this topic in a minute or two. I think it's worth assuming, if you look at the way the campaign has played out to date, that Romney, despite these efforts, is not going to win anything close to a majority among Latino and Latina voters. But the goal is not to win that vote, but to win a significant enough a plurality of it in order to be able to be competitive in the rest of the election.
And let me just say one other thing. For Latinos, it's so important because also we have to get to the point where one party doesn't take us for granted and the other party ignores us. And I think that you see that transition happening now, which is best for the community.
And a profound challenge, not just on the immigration issues, but on many others in order to make that happen. Let's come back a little bit later to that question. I want to open this up to all of you guys in just one moment, but I want to finally give Alex a chance to get the last word in. One of the things that I think most of you who take classes at Annenberg know, and those who follow politics know, is that unlike all of you in this room tonight, a relatively small percentage of Americans will actually watch these convention speeches, either Governor Romney's or President Obama's. And the overwhelming number of voters will get their information from those speeches, not directly from watching them, but from the news media, from television coverage, online coverage, newspaper, radio, or some combination. And so ultimately what happens is very short snippets, sound bites of those speeches get selected and played and played repeatedly. I think if you listen to our three panelists, there's no question that the news coverage is going to very heavily reflect Romney's efforts to humanize himself and his discussion about the economy. But there's one other soundbite that really struck me, and I know it struck you, Alex, and I'm wondering if you happen to have it handy and can talk for a minute about why it struck you. Do you happen to have it?
I do not. If you can repeat that, I would love to
speak. We'll get it in just a minute, and we'll come back with it. So with that, let's open it up to questions from all of you guys. And as is our want here, I'm going to simply ask you two things before you ask your question. Number one, if you can tell us before you ask who you are, so we know who we're talking to. And number two, in particular, if you happen to be asking a question of someone with whom you might disagree, we ask that you address them as respectfully as that you would hope that they would address you if they were disagreeing with something that you had said. So why don't we come to you?
Hello, I'm Gabby Cannon. I'm a specialized journalism master's student. My question is basically open to the panel. I know we've been talking a lot about that one of the goals is to connect with probably moderate voters at this point. So my question is that, two of you seem to think that you really did hit those marks. And you talked about women, he was introduced by the Muslim Latino community. So I guess my question is, how important is it to disguise that strategy? And if that'll play into all that authenticity, the issue of trust. So if we know as viewers that he's trying to use these marks, does that discredit him at all?
Why don't we go to the former communications director and ask her, Margita? Is it Gabby? It's a terrific question.
It is a good question.
So
How much pandering is too much pandering?
Exactly.
Yeah. Do voters understand when a candidate is speaking to a particular sector of the audience, and do they feel put off by that?
You know, it's an absolutely fantastic question when you think about what is it that you're trying to portray, what context are you trying to provide, and are you hitting people over the head with it? I think everyone knows what's happening right now. I also think that what you're seeing at the convention, though, is a generational shift, when you're seeing less and less of the people that before, I'm a moderate Republican, so I'd be like, oh my God, what are they gonna say? Pat Buchanan, you know, is he gonna be unplugged? Ah! You have less of that, and now you have these new faces and new voices. I'd never heard Susana Martinez speak, I'd never heard Rubio, so it's kind of fun and exciting. So there's an authenticity, getting back to that word again, so there's still an authenticity because they are the rising stars of the party. Now, are they the rising stars because they deserve it, or because they're Latino, or because they're women? You know, it's probably a little bit of everything mixed together. But it's important to make sure that you don't pander too far, or you leave the question there. Like, I have to say, as a Latina, I don't remember what the timing was, but President Obama announced something about the DREAM Act, and he did it at a particular time. Oh, yeah. It was just like so weird, the timing, where it was so obvious that it was pandering. I don't remember what the catalyst was.
He was about to go to speak to a national convention of Latino elected officials.
Okay, well, there you go. So you make your big Latino announcements. What people, the news media who analyze it kind of expected. It is what it is. But I think that's one of the things where eventually the proof is in the pudding. If he was to be elected, would you end up seeing that happened when President Bush, then Governor Bush, had his convention, lots of Latinos there, and he really did care a lot about the Latino community in a unique way, and I would hope that would prove itself out if Mitt Romney is to win.
And Gabe, there's candidates, some are more skilled than others, and some are better off at targeting this message toward a particular group without alienating others, others also. But I would think, and I'd love to get your thoughts on this as a journalist. Back in the days before communications technology gave us such a wider range of media sources, it was a lot easier for a politician to target a message to a particular audience. I could go to San Francisco and give a speech about one thing, and come to Los Angeles and give a speech.
It wouldn't chase you around the internet.
Precisely.
Right. Something you said 20 years ago, or something like that.
It's a lot tougher to pull off today, isn't it?
That's a good question, and I don't think there's an easy answer to that, because I think that with so many more media outlets, you also have so many more opportunities to speak to a particular audience in a way that you didn't before. And I think really, actually, one of the reasons why I think these campaigns are so much nastier than they were even just a few years ago is because there's a proliferation of media outlets, and media outlets, when there was only one of them, they have to speak to sort of a more, a broader audience, and the media outlet itself is conscious not to alienate its own viewers. Now we've got media outlets that really, you know, incite a much more spirited response, and I think that candidates pick that up. So I think it's a complicated question. But a good one, so.
Okay, let's go to better questions than mine then. Who else has a question? Yes?
This is a guy, my name's Simon Rudd, by the way. I'm a PhD student in political science. I guess I'm gonna just give my reaction. I hope it spurs some reaction from you briefly. I guess normally we think of elections as two sides fighting over the middle, but the thing with the Romney speech, which, although I think he talked actually very effectively about his family and about his wife, we haven't seen any kind of, he's still part of the Republican Party, and they still have that problem with their brand when it comes to women voters, whether it's Todd Akin or whether it's policy positions or what have you. He still has problems with Latino voters because they've abandoned the Bush approach of perhaps being more open-minded on immigration or supporting the DREAM Act. And so he's kind of boxed in by his party to a certain extent. And I think this also helps explain the Paul Ryan hit. And perhaps rather than seeing it as a fight for the middle, are we not just trying to sort of dampen enthusiasm on one side of the aisle and pump up enthusiasm on the other side, and basically seeing this as a turnout election rather than a fight for a vanishing middle which doesn't really exist?
But I will, I'll take first crack at that if it's okay with the panel. And Simon, I think you're, I think the final conclusion of your question is exactly the right one. Your questions about Romney's challenges are precisely right. They're mirrored by similar challenges that Obama faces with his own party, which is why we have essentially a tied race at this point. But Simon's broader point is an excellent one.
When Margita and I came up in politics, her many, many years after I did, but still a few years ago, we were taught what was called the 80-20 rule. The campaign spends 80% of its time talking to the middle 20% of the electorate. And what we've seen in American politics, for a lot of reasons, many at least having to do with the point that Gabe was making just a moment ago about the nature of news media coverage, is the electorate has become more and more polarized. And there was a Pew Foundation poll done with NBC that came out about a week and a half ago that showed that 20% of the electorate was not undecided. 10% of the electorate was not undecided. In fact, 3% of the electorate was undecided. And I think your question and your assessment is a very perceptive one, which is if you are a strategist for either Romney or Obama, and you think, should I spend 80% of my time and effort talking to that middle 3%? Or should I spend all that time and energy and effort trying to motivate my most loyal supporters to turn out on election day? I think you're exactly right. There are certainly some efforts to turn out what's left of the political center in this country, but I think for the most part, what you'll see at the conventions and in the weeks going forward is much more of an effort for Republicans to rally their most conservative supporters and Democrats to motivate their most liberal backers.
I think you're right, Dan, but I got to say that I was so surprised when I heard that stat, and it seems to me that I think the campaigns were also somewhat surprised, because if you recall the famous Etch-a-Sketch comment that they were going to reboot the campaign for the general election and sort of talk to the middle, that seems to have sort of been thrown out. And you're right. I mean, a lot of this is to energize the base. There really doesn't seem to be a middle. But that wasn't true even an election ago, I think. I mean, the middle was much more, it was much vaster, it was much more decisive than it seems to. It's incredibly polarized, and very few have made up their mind. I mean, very few still have to make up their mind.
I would say as well, in the medium term, these demographics are changing. This might be the last election for the Republicans, and this might work.
That's a point that I hear often, right? I mean, they're kind of, this is the shoot the moon election, right?
And this is really the balance that has led to an even race. I've seen poll numbers that, given the shortfall that Margita talked about, that Republicans face among Latino voters and certainly among African Americans as well, for Romney to win this election, he will need to win support of just over 60% of the white voters in this country. And of course, that leaves a challenge for Obama to win a 40% margin among white voters, which speaks to a polarized electorate, not just ideologically, but demographically also. Alex, I'm going to ask you a question, because it gets to the kind of swing vote we were talking about. 4 years ago, one of the engines that fueled Obama's election outcome was another demographic group, young voters. And because I have a keen powers of observation, I noticed a couple of young voters in the room here tonight. One of the most interesting things I've seen in this election is that the levels of support for Obama among 18 to 25-year-olds, when compared to the Republican nominee, are not that different than 4 years ago. What seems to be different, and this is something that perhaps, is our friend Aaron Taxi here also? Aaron, maybe this is something that Eric can talk to also. It appears that Obama's greatest challenge is not so much losing young voters to Romney, but motivating them to turn out in the same numbers as 4 years ago. Two-part question, first for Alex, and then for Aaron. Why do Republicans face such difficulty in attracting younger voters? And second, in fairness, since you have to answer the first one, why is Obama having such more difficulty motivating those voters this year than last?
I think Mitt Romney's having a problem more with the social issues that he's been talking about recently with young voters. A lot of young voters, they are apathetic to the social issues. They're more libertarian leaning, in my opinion. And you see that when the base of the Republican Party is very socially conservative, and Mitt Romney has moved more to the right on social issues, that the younger voters kind of feel disaffected. Now, at the same time, I think that Barack Obama is having huge trouble with that young demographic, because the economy is struggling, because they were really looking for that hope and change 4 years ago, and it hasn't happened. It really just has not come to fruition. And when 40%, I saw a recent poll that 40% of young voters are going for Mitt Romney, and 60% are going for Barack Obama. And that when half of young voters can't find a job after graduation, and they have these student loans, that they really just, they can't get excited about Barack Obama at this point, and they feel that they, that in my opinion, I'm seeing a lot more young voters coming around to Mitt Romney because he is more pro-business, more fiscally conservative, more pro-entrepreneurial spirit, and he believes in the ideas that will get this economy going back again.
In fairness, and although this is the Republicans' night and we'll do this with the Democrats a week from tonight, it is only fair to give our friend Aaron Taxi, the president of the College Democrats, a chance to weigh in on the same question. And same for you, Aaron, in reverse. One tougher, one easier. Number one, why is Obama still doing, has he done, and why is he still doing so well among young voters in terms of partisan preference? And when you finish that softball, then go on to the second question, which is talk about the challenges of remoting that younger voter base in 2012. Stand up.
I agree with Alex that Mitt Romney's views on social issues that have shifted ever rightward over the past few years definitely contribute to the fact that he's having trouble with young voters. But I think that one of the reasons why Barack Obama I think one of the reasons why Barack Obama is doing much better amongst young voters, and I think it was mentioned earlier, is sort of this Clintonian idea of he can feel the young person's pain a lot more. He's focused much of his time in office on increasing Pell Grants, preserving Pell Grants, and he talks about student issues and identifies with them in a way, and young people feel that, and I don't think that they necessarily feel the same the same level of identification from Mitt Romney. The second question, which is, what does Obama need to do?
I'll frame it in the same challenging way I put it to Alex. Why is the president having more difficulty motivating the youngest voters in this election compared to 2008?
I mean, I think that one of the reasons why he's having trouble motivating young voters is a reason, it's actually what he said on campus when he came here 2 years ago, is, you know, as much as he said, change takes time. There was this such great enthusiasm around his first election that, and yet there was far less instant gratification. And while the economy has been improving, while there's been steady job creation over the past many months, there is still a lot more work to be done. And you know, Alex and I might disagree with who the man is to do it, but Barack Obama's job at this point with students is to remind them what he has done for them in regards to student loans, Pell Grants, and that things are getting better. That should be his narrative.
Aaron, thank you very much. Unlike Alex, who was asked to do this several days ago and has had some time to prepare, Aaron thought he was coming tonight as an innocent bystander. And so we appreciate you standing up and in providing us with an even-handed discussion. Margita, I want to ask you a follow-up. Having watched this byplay, we talked earlier about the imperative for Romney of talking about the economy, and in fact, it is almost everything you talked about tonight. And when I watch this campaign, I've come to a pretty direct conclusion. Every day that Romney gets to talk about the economy is a good day for Mitt Romney. Every day that Mitt Romney talks about something other than the economy is a good day for Barack Obama. And listening to Alex talk about jobs and listening to Aaron talk about Pell Grants, it strikes me that the more that this election conversation stays focused on one single issue, the more advantageous that is to Romney. The challenge, however, is there are voters, as you identified earlier, who care about issues like abortion, who care about issues like same-sex marriage, who care about issues like immigration. Can you carry on a single-issue conversation in a presidential campaign?
First of all, I just want to commend you all being here at USC, just seeing that back-and-forth exchange. It was so well-mannered and polite and on the issues, and I just, if people could discuss issues where they disagree in a way that's really focused on trying to distill the solution, or not even the solution, just being allowed to express themselves, we'd be a lot better. So I just want to say I'm very impressed with you guys, how you've been composing and comporting yourself.
Well, you should, They are pretty impressive, but you should see these well-mannered young men and women the week before the UCLA game.
All right, that being said, I am coming at this, I'm working in the private sector right now, and so what it really drives home to me is this notion of market segmentation. How do you segment your market while at the same time having your brand promise? And so right now, to me, Mitt Romney's brand promise is all about talking about the economy and jobs. You want to segment your market, and how are you going to kind of divvy up between these specialty markets, which could be Latinos, it could be the youth, it could be Mormons, you know, however you want to divide it. But one of the things that's interesting is that everyone's feeling the pain of this economy. So you may say that it's important to talk about the Pell Grants or that things are getting better, this or that, but I think one of the things that Alex said is really important is that they're not able to get jobs. You know, oh, you can, Paul Ryan, you can look at the faded Obama poster, but at the same time you're doing it from your parents' home because you can't get a job. So I think that that issue is more and more resonant with these different micro segment with these different market segments. So I do think that the Republicans hope that that's enough to motivate people and to drive change in voting behavior and get people to pivot away from some of those social issues that may drive them away and really focus on getting out.
And clearly we saw that in Romney's speech tonight, just as we'll see the mirror image of it in Obama's a week from tonight. Gabe, let me follow up on that with you, though. We were talking earlier about, for lack of better terms, respect versus trust. Idea, okay, Romney knows his stuff on the economy, but I'm not quite sure I trust him on it, say voters. In some way, does talking about these other issues, does talking about education, talking about healthcare, talking about immigration, even though they are policy matters and not personal anecdotes, does talking about that broader range of issues help a candidate establish that trust?
Well, I mean, I think we got to talk about which candidate, right? I mean, I think that you're right. I would agree with your first statement that, yes, every day Romney can talk about the economy, it's a good day for him, right? And I think that actually Obama probably has more of an opportunity to segment his audience than does Romney. Obama actually can point to a lot of different initiatives on education. He's been in office for 4 years, right? So he's actually got a record on a lot of these things in immigration, et cetera, et cetera. And I think that's a much more difficult thing for Romney. I think with Romney, it's really just about shoring up the base, and particularly in the context of a convention where you've got all these different factions here and everybody wants to have their scraps sort of thrown at them. I got to say, though, when you said about, you know, Romney talking about the economy, I got to say, it's I feel now in, what is this, day four of the convention, day three, what is it, how many days have we had here? Three. I feel like I've been eating, like, cake icing for 3 days here, and, you know, I'm not getting a lot of nourishment. I'm starting to sort of break out in sweats. I think the more that we talk about, like, the more that I hear the Republicans talk about the economy, the more that I actually am eager for some type of substance on that, and I'm still getting very, very little of that. And I think that, you know, as I mentioned to you earlier, this really kind of reminds me a little bit of 2004, when it was the Democrats thought that they could make it all a mandate on Bush's first term and an unpopularity of a war, et cetera, et cetera, and they chose the anti-Bush as their candidate. And that was the campaign, and it was, I'm not him. And I still hear a lot of that right now. I hear a lot of that. I hear every speech is about how dire things are now and how horrible this president is and how much he's lost his way and how he doesn't know where the exit is, et cetera, et cetera. And I think that that's effective up to a point. And I don't think it carries you the whole way. And I think that we need a little bit more substance from the Republicans in a way that the American people can understand, which, as we know, does not involve nuance. But
you know, I think you're right on that one. And I think the Romney campaign agreed with you for most of the year also, which is just being the un-Obama is good enough. And my impression, at least, is the selection of Paul Ryan for all the positive and negative it brings was an acknowledgement by the Romney campaign that our guy can't just be an Obama, we gotta present something else. Now, rolling the dice on Medicare is a pretty risky proposition. Every 10 years or so, Republicans say, we think the American people are ready for a direct, honest, difficult conversation about entitlements, and every 10 years, the American people prove them wrong. So we'll see if this is any more successful. But I'd suggest to you that the Ryan pick was essentially Romney saying,
yeah, he's outsourcing his economic policy.
Gabe Kahn is right, says Mitt Romney.
Of course, that should be their slogan. You got another question over there?
Yes.
Yeah, I have a question about something that maybe it wasn't emphasized, but it's something that's weighing on my mind, and that's foreign policy. Yet only a few comments, but all of them were very hard-hitting in a way. He talked about how Obama is talking to Iran while the centrifuges are spinning. the implicit message being that he would not talk, he would bomb. It was very, unsettling. There was those lines about Putin that seemed to be almost, directly sort of, attacking him in a sense. And I don't know if you would win voters that way, but it sure would insult Putin, I think. And then there were, statements about China both last night and tonight that at one point even evoked booing from the audience. And it seems like there is a nexus of foreign policy and the economy when we have such a massive military that consumes, about half of our discretionary budget. And I guess what I'm wondering is, in terms of signaling, when he's saying these things, who exactly is he talking to and what is he telling us? Is he basically saying that he is going to be a neocon kind of foreign policy president? Or is this really just kind of throwaway lines to, the base of the Republican Party?
I'll ask our panelists to weigh in just a second, but I didn't catch your name, I'm sorry. Ron, I think it's a terrific set of questions, and I'll offer a couple of thoughts before asking these guys to weigh in. I'll offer you two main points. Number one, for the first time in probably half a century, the Democratic nominee for president is not operating at a significant disadvantage on issues relating to national security. And that of course, having to do with the death of Osama bin Laden and Gaddafi and the end of the war in Iraq and pending end of the war in Afghanistan. So whether Obama wins significant numbers of votes on foreign policy and national defense is an open question in an election driven about the economy, but it's not a hole that the Democratic candidate has to climb out of for probably the first time since Kennedy. Is that fair game?
I'm thinking back here. Yeah.
So point number one, Obama has some credentials on this front that most Americans believe to be credible. The second point I'd make, more broadly, not just on Romney, but more generally, is presidential candidates, particularly challengers to incumbents, tend to sound a lot more provocative on the stump than they are when they get to office. And if you watch the last several decades of American foreign policy, there's never really nearly as much change once a president takes office as it sounded like there was going to be on the campaign trail. If you listen to Romney carefully, not so much tonight, what he's essentially saying, for example, on Afghanistan, is I would have stuck to Obama's timetable, but I wouldn't have announced it. He's saying, I wouldn't bomb Iran, but I would use tougher adjectives. He is saying, I disagree with what Obama did as it related to Israel in the Middle East in 2009 and 2010, less to say now. Just as Bill Clinton promised to be tough on China, just as Barack Obama promised to close Guantanamo, Mitt Romney has a set of political imperatives to sound like he's much more dramatically different than in fact he probably would be. Fair, unfair? Alex?
I think he's going back to a tenet of Reagan's 1980 campaign. American people do want a president that sounds tough. That you don't want a president that goes to the Russian people and talks about being flexible after his election. These are red flags to the American people. Mitt Romney's pointing them out. I don't think he said anything that was out of the ordinary. You want presidents, whether you think that he would actually take these actions, you want presidents that are tough, that speak out and speak out for their convictions and talk about what they would do, talk about what they believe in and what the structure of their foreign policy should be. Again, on China, Barack Obama did the same thing in 2008. He went up there in 2008, Barack Obama, and he said that I'm going to take China to the mat. That was one of his big tenets. He said, I'm going to make sure that China does not cheat and steal. And Mitt Romney is, as a businessman, he understands that there is an opening there, that there is something there that he truly understands that the economy does not benefit because of China's cheating. A lot of these issues, I think, resonate with the American people, and that's my personal opinion, and I will go with Margita.
I'll say a couple things. First of all, your questions in the evening are much harder than the questions you usually have at lunch. And also, I'm very impressed, Alex, making reference to 1980 elections, 1992 elections.
Well, Alex, as you may not know, was a senior advisor to the Reagan campaign in 1980.
So one of the things I'll say that's interesting about Mitt Romney, let's point out China in particular, he's probably someone as a business person that most understands some of the economic underpinnings of what's driving China, much more so than anyone else. it's interesting because you have this dynamic, I would say even with immigration, where on one level people are talking about close the borders, you know, are people going to self-deport, all of this stuff, but at the same time the reality is people are trying to hire Latinos, it's the fastest growing market, et cetera. So I think that you would probably see with Romney a much more economic driven philosophy and in terms of engagement on foreign policy as opposed to maybe some of the what you might interpret as vitriol that was spoken tonight.
Gabe, let's assume that it is easier to make menacing noises toward other countries as a candidate than as president. As somebody who's covered economic issues very closely, talk a little bit about what some of the downsides might be of as aggressive approach toward China as Romney in 2012 or Obama in 2008 or other candidates over the last decade or so have offered.
Okay. Well, I think, you know, quite simply, there's a lot of just misconceptions about what our economic relationship with China is. The place where it crops up the most is in currency policy. And here we get a lot of confusion from both sides. Rick Perry was talking about how we need a strong dollar as if that was the sort of same thing as a strong defense policy. That's a complete misinterpretation of what our economic situation is and how it impacts China. A weak dollar would be great for American exports and terrible for Chinese imports, right? So a weak dollar policy is something that reduces our trade deficit with China. Very few politicians get up there and say, I'm for a weak dollar. It doesn't sound good. People don't really understand what that means. The issues of cheating with China are much more difficult to tackle and to address, I think, on a policy basis. China's now part of the WTO. There should be sort of some safeguards there. It's unclear what the policy levers, I guess, that you pull are for that. But don't forget that when we talk about our relationship with China, we're really often talking about American companies who produce goods there and then sell them to Americans at prices that we've come to expect that are quite low. Getting tough with China also means higher priced goods at Target and Walmart.
It's unfair to ask even anybody as good as Gabe to talk about U.S.-China economic and trade policy in 90 seconds or less. For those of you, though, who I think appreciate a more, even more in-depth conversation on these issues, as many of you know, in addition to our evening programs, not only next week but for the presidential and vice presidential debates, we also every Wednesday sponsor lunch from 11:30 to 1 in the Taper Center. And we co-sponsor those lunches with the Center for Communications Leadership here at Annenberg and the Bedrosian Center for Public Policy over at the Price School. And over the course of the fall, we'll be examining several different policy aspects of the campaign in a little bit more depth than we've given our panelists the chance to tonight. And we hope you'll join us for those lunches as well. Before we wrap up tonight, any last questions from any of you guys? Yes.
Hello. My name is Giuseppe Rovino. I'm a freshman, business administration, focused on international relations major. And my question is mostly a public policy slash blended with, like, as panelists who are experts in media communications and the culture at large, how they respond to communications. Romney did something that I thought was very strategic and very important tonight, and that is he spent a few seconds discussing Bain Capital, and he tried to promote that and put that in somewhat a better perspective for people to not demonize him and so much as they have. And of course, the Obama administration campaigns on the fact that also that he will continue the Bush policies, the quote-unquote deregulation policies that got us into this economic mess. So in fact, Romney wouldn't be good for the economy. My question is this, has there been any mention of perhaps the argument that it was the same government, the Community Reinvestment Act, that got us into the housing crisis, that it was government forcing banks to give those loans, or that Bain Capital, even though they would send jobs overseas, that's just, in fact, just economics working the way it is, pointing out that maybe it's unions and regulations that actually cause the jobs to go overseas in the first place. Does the public respond to these types of arguments? Are they normally made in a campaign? How come we don't see so much of this as just most of that more like emotional, like focus on emotion and relating, and less of these like facts just to throw out there? as basically his communications panel.
As I count questions about housing, questions about housing, questions about Bain, questions about the role of government in U.S. economic growth, as you correctly framed it as a policy, cultural, economic, business, communications, and media question. You each have 15 seconds to answer. I heard two overarching questions in that, and I think you raised a series of important points. Number one, which we've talked about a little bit before, is the policy versus personality discussion. And Gabe, you said earlier that the conventions in particular are personality driven in terms of message, some more policy as the campaign progresses, but still not a real dig deep in that respect. The other question, in a nod to substance, which I'd like to put to you guys, is really one about the role of the government in the economy. And I would suggest to you that as you watch this campaign progress over its last nine plus weeks, think that this is a campaign between Bain and Solyndra, for whom Obama and Romney just happen to be helpful proxies. And if you look at Romney's experience with Bain Capital, whether you think it's a good one or not, when you look at the Obama administration's experience, not just with the Solyndra company, but other private sector investments, whether you approve of them or not, they really do point to a fundamentally different approach as to how a government ought to conduct itself during an economic downturn. And the Obama believes a more aggressive approach is appropriate. Romney believes in a smaller role for government and larger for the private sector. Is that, yeah, underneath everything else we've talked about tonight, is that a legitimate way of looking at the differences in economic policies between the two candidates?
I think actually that's not a bad way to sort of frame it, but I think that there's actually a lot more that goes into it than just sort of holding up a Solyndra or a Bain.
Just to clarify, the Bain versus Solyndra is sort of a glib way of leading into private.
Let me put it this way. I mean, I think we all know the expression, there's no atheists in foxholes. In a severe economic downturn, everyone is a Keynesian. So I think the point is that when you've got the Dow at 6,000, when you've got unemployment in double digits, nobody wants to be the president who says, we're going to step out of the way and let this fix itself. That's a very difficult bill of goods to sell to the American people. When you have an economy in crisis, people want an activist government. And that's certainly what we saw during 4 years of Obama, with decidedly mixed results. The issue is that now we're hearing that the solution is for government to sort of step out of the way, and all these promises that have been made tonight will take care of themselves once government gets out of the way. It sounds good, but it's when actually you're in office trying to sell that, I think it becomes quite difficult.
And Alex, the Romney economic message is just that a more aggressive role for the private sector and a smaller role for the government does lead to economic growth.
Yeah, my question is, why is it okay for Barack Obama to spend our money and invest in companies, and it's not okay for Mitt Romney to use his money to invest in companies? And you saw tonight that he cited some examples that Barack Obama and Michelle Obama have lauded. Staples. Bill Clinton talked about Bain Capital as a success. I think that it's pretty interesting that you see Barack Obama come out here and talk about that he wants to raise taxes on small businesses and on people who create the jobs in this country. How are you going to have wealth? How are you going to have more success? How are you going to create jobs when you want to increase taxes and regulations on those people? And I just want to finish up, last thing I would say about this whole situation is that Bain Capital, for whatever you want to say, is one of the most successful stories out there. That you saw Mitt Romney build a company from 6 employees to hundreds and hundreds. You see big business. This is what you want in this country. And I think that at the end of the day, the American people, when this issue is brought to their table, and we see the comparisons between the two sides, you'll see that the American people go with the Romney economic plan.
And strong words as appropriate from the chair of the Campus Romney Organization. And in the interests of the type of discussions we like to have here, we will not call on Aaron again tonight, either Aaron or one of his colleagues will be sitting up at this table to discuss the Obama speech 1 week from tonight. Alex, very well framed argument on the governor's behalf. Margita, let's wind up with you. As Alex points out, Romney does argue for a more aggressive private sector and a smaller role for government. In a difficult economic climate, when an increasing number of voters are relying on government services, does that argument become a more challenging one to sell?
First of all, I just want to say at the end of the evening that I can tell that as a press secretary, if someone was to be like, oh, Gabe's on the phone and wants to talk to you, it would be an awful call. And I'd be like, no, I'm not there. Tell him I'm out.
I always call back.
I feel like I have a master's in public policy, and I feel like I'd have to get all my old textbooks out in order to be able to talk to you.
I just want to say I'm never going to choose to go first before Alex.
And secondly, I know, Alex, you have a career as a press secretary. I have to tell you, you really have a good calling. I would hire you in a second. So I have to say, a lot of it is about values, and that's one of the things that we haven't talked about here. And so as you're listening to a speech like this, there's going to be these emotional levers that are going to pull you one way or the other. I think one of the key things that Romney said that really just spoke to my heartstrings was that risk doesn't necessarily mean you're always going to be successful. And we talk about America giving equal opportunity, not necessarily securing equal outcome. So I think those are things that resonate with my values. And so therefore, I think that that's probably a lot of Republicans might resonate with that value. So that's one thing. I do think it's really hard for people who are more and more dependent on state and government and federal help. But they don't necessarily like it. People want to work. I mean, I think that's the Puritan nature of our country, is that people, by their very nature, want to work and want to have that opportunity, and they're seeing what is the barrier to that job creation. And so that's what I think the root is.
People want to work, and they want help when they can't work, and the result of that discussion is an absolutely tied presidential campaign with 9 weeks to go until Election Day. Join me, though, in thanking Gabe Kahn and thanking Alex Yeabry and in thanking Morgita Thompson for a terrific conversation. Thanks as well to our friends from Annenberg, from the Annenberg School for Communication and for the Center for Communication Leadership. Thank you all very, very much for your help tonight. We appreciate it. Thanks to the team at the Jess Unruh Institute of Politics, Kirsten Chui, Andrena, Laura, and our entire team of student workers. Guys, we couldn't do this without you. Thank you very, very much.